Yeah, the program is still Good Morning Abuja. If you just tune in, showing on NT Channel 5, the Unity Station. Now we have a guest in the studio who will be talking about something very important to you and I. Like, this is one thing that we cannot do without in any society. What am I talking about? I am simply talking about agriculture. Yesterday we have a guest. His name is Ijeoma Bennett. Not a female, it is a man. Actually also has the same question. Why are you called Ijeoma? Because Ijeoma that I know are usually women. And he explained the meaning of the name to me, and it's a very sweet meaning. So join us as we make welcome Ijeoma Bennett. He is the chief partner Bennett Smith Sim Company. Together we're going to be talking about agriculture as a pivotal tool to improve the nation's economy. Good morning, Mr. Ijeoma.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Ijeoma.
How are you today?
Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me on your show this morning.
Yes, you're welcome.
It's a wonderful opportunity to expound on the great uses of agriculture in our nation, Nigeria. Thank you once again for having me.
Thank you for coming. So, let's shoot. The first question. What is the importance of agriculture in the Nigerian economy?
Okay, agriculture is basically one of the mainstays of a nation. I know the produce of agriculture gives birth to the food that we eat every day. Mm-hmm. And we have come to understand that if we do not look at agriculture as an integral part of our nation's development, then we might be having some challenges in some areas trying to meet up. Nigeria is one of the most populous black nations in the world, and God has blessed us with a lot of natural resources. Mm. And yet, with all that means with all of that, we have an abundance of people, and then we have an abundance of natural resources. Mm-hmm. However, we are still one of the nations, according to the National Bureau of Statistics data that was issued in January of this year. We have about 63% of the peoples of the nation living in multidimensional poverty. And why should that be taking place in a country as rich as us? It's not supposed to be the state.
And do you believe the statistics?
The statistics, based on our day-to-day one-on-one with a lot of individuals, there are so many complaints going in and going out. And based off those complaints, I understood that, okay, we have to start to look at different aspects of what could make our nation prosperous, especially for the individuals. Because when we look at it, if we have a nation complaining so much, it means that the cost of living is very high. The cost of living is very high, it becomes an issue. And the cost of living being very high it comes from the level of inflation. The last statistics that came out from CBN, we had about an average of about 22% inflation rate, which will basically affect every aspect of life. It will affect our purchasing power. It mm-hmm. will affect every index of our normal everyday living. So basically from that, if we have to work on our inflation rate, mm-hmm. therefore we have to look at the economy of the nation. And the economy of the nation is basically, for if I remember my small economics from secondary mm-hmm. school, it's basically buying and selling.
Yeah.
Buying and selling will balance a nation. Mm-hmm. And therefore, looking at the balance of trade for our nation, which is basically export and import.
Yeah.
We are actually in a balance of trade deficit, mm-hmm. which needs to be worked upon. And that is because we are doing more imports than we are doing exports.
Yeah.
So what I had to do was I took out time to look at what is it we're exporting, what is it we're importing.
Yeah.
And for a lot of us, we'll know from the statistics that was released by NBS, still over 88% of our export still heavily reliant on crude oil and liquefied natural gas. Mm. So Then I went to look at the other indexes, and agriculture just had about 2% on it. 2% wow. Export. And,
well, we can do a lot.
Yes, it's not at all. And I looked at it vis-a-vis the remainder, because we just have about 9% to work with. So agriculture, which is integral, needs to be looked at critically.
We can do a lot with that.
Critically.
Yes, it's when we look at the economies before now, if you go back eons ago, centuries ago, civilization started from agroeconomy. Mm-hmm. People owned land.
Yes. Yeah.
And then with owning the land, you control the crops. And then when you control the crops, you also control the people, so to speak. But even when you have your castles in that area and aspect, you're able to feed the towns. Mm-hmm. And then from feeding the towns, you grow the population. So you basically had an established system, even though it was agro-run, but it was a self-sufficient established system.
Yeah, so I think a lot of people had plantations around their, houses. So before we still go into, the export and the import,
yes.
there have been propositions of agriculture. So yes. What models would you advise for implementation?
Yeah, for implementation, what I would I and a group of people we came together, basically, and we know that the real estate is one of the burgeoning areas that contribute to our GDP, and people are interested in real estate. But beyond being interested just in real estate, we also had to look at how real estate could tie in with agronomy. And then we understood that, okay, if we get these areas of land, we can turn them to farmland. Yeah, so the owners, when they get the lands, they buy the farmland.
Okay.
It becomes their property, so they have real estate, so to speak. Now, they are able to cultivate on those lands. And once they're able to cultivate on those lands, if they are unable to cultivate on those lands, we have the experts that their business is to cultivate those lands and then to get the produce to ensure that to get the produce to end users. And what we're basically focusing on now is cassava and then palm oil, because looking at the index of agricultural produce that we export, Nigeria is the number one exporter of cassava around the world.
Okay.
And yet, cassava is not among the top 10 produce that is exported in Nigeria for agricultural products. Oh. So that means there is a huge market. Yes, that needs to be exploited. And one of the ingredients of cassava, which is sorbitol, has the propensity to generate revenue 10 times the export of cassava. So we use sorbitol to produce things like toothpaste, things like mouthwash, right? And then it's also used in the pharmaceutical industries. Once you get once it goes through process, one of the ingredients of cassava can be used in the pharmaceutical industries. We also have a biofuel that can be produced from cassava, which is ethanol, which we use to drink our daily refreshments of beer and all that. So the propensity for us to turn and churn and maximize on especially the production of cassava, which will contribute greatly to the nation's GDP, is very wide. And I think that's one of the aspects of agriculture that we should look at, because first and foremost is the staple ingredient that we have in our nation.
So you're talking about cassava, you're talking about palm oil.
Yes, palm oil.
I think cashew is another thing that we should also look into.
Yeah.
Cashew, right?
Yeah, and a lot of people think we get cashew elsewhere. But cashew, we get them here. If you go around Abuja, we have lots of trees of cashew.
Yeah, cashew trees.
Yes, possibly it's because of the gestation period for the cashew to be.
It takes time.
Yes, it takes a lot of time. For even palm oil, it's not the return on investment is not immediate.
So cassava does not take that long.
Cassava is a 1-year period. Okay. It's a one-year period, which you can have two productions in a year.
In a year. Oh,
yes,
okay.
You can have two productions in a year. And then there is an in-demand market for it locally and internationally.
Yeah.
Yes. So if we're able to leverage on it, I think it contributes exponentially to our nation's GDP. So that's one. The other produces that we have as a nation include sesame oil. We are the second highest exporters of sesame, right?
In the world.
I actually thought, yes, you know, we don't really have it here.
No.
I think it was like a week ago that I get to know that we produce a lot of sesame.
And the thing with sesame also is that in the production of sesame,
very healthy.
In the production of sesame, what we do basically as a nation is just to export it instead of taking it through
The process of
taking it through processing. Increases the revenue instead of us to export sesame and then we'll now import the oil. No, if we
so on that case, what advice will you give the Nigerian government when it comes to, like, you know, probably we don't have the machines.
We definitely have
to do those process.
Yeah. And from what it looks like, we have them, but we don't know what to do with them.
We don't know what to do with
them. Let's take a break. When we return, we're thinking about what you tell us and the Nigerian government, especially about all the things you've said. It's time to take a short break. We will be right back.
The jingle bells have started ringing and the Christmas spirit has filled the air. NTA Channel 5 Abuja is organizing a memorable Christmas party for children in the Federal Capital Territory. Come and experience a time of your life in our fun-filled party with dancing competition, exciting games, bouncing castles, attractive gifts from the Santa's Grotto, and lots of food and drink. Date of the party is 16th of December 2023. Venue, NTA Channel 5 Abuja Premises Area 10, beside Old Parade Ground. The time is 12 noon. Gate fee is 1,000 Naira. For sponsorship and partnership, contact the marketing department, NTA Channel 5 Abuja. Don't miss out on this fun. Merry Christmas.
Happy Christmas, everybody. Rice and stew go plenty for the seas.
I welcome you on today's ride on the show, Good Morning Abuja.
This is Window on Abuja.
We have everything it takes to compete with any nation all across the world.
How do we make it? We are ready to produce.
I've been contributing to the development of your kingdom.
Hello and welcome to Young Hearts.
Our focus today will be on hepatitis B.
Ladylike!
This is Entertainment Gist.
In the 14th century, 15th, 16th century, and even 17th.
That is for zakah, to cure our greed.
The purpose why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to create humanity.
The Bible talks about a man called Apollos.
Somebody give a price!
This is NTA Abuja Channel 5.
See you same time.
And have a great and blessed week ahead.
Welcome back from that short break. Now it's time to continue with our topic this morning. Before we went on the break, we were talking about things that Nigeria can produce or things that Nigeria has in bulk, yet we do not really take advantage of these things. Instead, we export most of these things. So now let's talk about, I am particular about this sesame seed. We have, for those of you who don't know what sesame seed is, that is what they call ready in Hausa. And I know many people like that. Really. So now let's talk about sesame seed. Tell us more about it. And maybe other produce that we really don't know much about, yet we export to other countries.
It's just like giving them on a platter of gold.
Do you get?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sesame seeds, sesame seeds are one of the highest export products that we have in our nation, Nigeria. Is second only after cocoa. Wow. Second only after cocoa. And Even though we have that high export of sesame seeds as a nation, we are not maximizing what we should do with it, which is basically taking it through processing so that we have the oils and then it increases our return revenue as a nation, right? And then we also have a rice production. Rice production is, we are in Africa, we are the number one, we're the highest producers of rice as a nation and then as in Africa, right? But the thing is that the amount of rice that we produce, about 8 million metric tons per annum, is not even enough for the nation. So we are unable to export. So there is a gap which we also need to exploit in that area. So one of the things that is very integral that is giving some challenges with regards to this is, I think the government's policies on agriculture need to be implemented.
Mm-hmm.
They actually really need to be implemented. Last year, the second half of last year, the national agricultural technological and innovation policy was initiated.
Okay.
Since then, I've not seen any programs directly inaugurated with regards to this that will help individual farmers, that will increase our production on every scale. On a year-on-year basis for the last 4 years, agriculture has basically grown marginally on an average of about 2%. It's not enough. So we have to introduce artificial intelligence. We have to introduce robotics.
Mm-hmm.
We have to introduce engineered seeds that will have speedy returns on their planting season. Right? Instead of something that takes 2 years could be in complete production in 1 year. Sometimes it could complete production in six months.
Yeah.
One of the produces that I know that we have done a lot of advancements on is soybean. Soybean has a 90-day turnover. And yet we are not still maximizing that. So I believe that the government needs to introduce subsidies, which will aid farmers, right, that are interested in doing these productions, to be genuinely interested and continue their production. It will also, because the cost of getting technical implements are quite expensive. So subsidies on getting the equipment, subsidies of getting the seeds, subsidy on land too. Subsidy on land too is also another aspect
very
we
important.
Should look at. Because if we do not have the lands that are allocated for us to gainfully or lawfully work on, how we will be able to work on it? And then we should also understand that in doing this, we are opening and paving the way for employment.
Yes.
A lot. The problem of employment will reduce drastically. Instead of the 37% average that we are having, it will reduce drastically. So I believe.
But the problem is, do you think some of our youth really want to go into farming?
I think the
maybe a modern day farming.
Yes, the challenge I feel we have is awareness.
Mm-hmm.
We
I
think,
agree with you.
Yes, we think
farming is all about holding your
goal. No. We are way.
You know, there's
past
something
that.
About the youth going to the true university, and then you've not been on the field land. So, what do you know about agriculture?
Exactly.
You just studied the course, and it's just the materials you have. But
if you look at it, Aisha, many people study the courses not because they really want to study these courses.
Exactly.
Maybe lack of the right courses they actually wanted in school.
So they just chose.
Just like some teachers. Sorry to say, many people are going to teaching not because they actually want to be teachers or even nursing.
Yeah.
In fact, I've heard some people's gist, like, let me just go. She wanted medicine. She's been failing. Let me just do. Do you understand?
It's the
so
same.
Tell me if that person will have the passion. She looks like the type of person that if she wants to give you injection, you don't keep your ticket. So many people really...
No, like he said, it's the awareness.
We need to create
that. And then, you know, once you understand how important it is, and then the export, how it can generate the foreign exchange, you know, the trade for the economy, I think the youth will
We'll put more interest.
It's also, apart from the awareness, the government needs to, the government really, really needs to put its focus on it.
Okay, now you're talking about the government.
Yes.
We all want the government to do this, to do that.
What do we do?
What do we do? That is one. Now you, Mr. Ijoma, by the grace of God, if given the opportunity to become the minister, I'm specifically say Minister of Agriculture. Tell me, what would you do differently?
How do you, change it?
What change will you bring into our agriculture, cultural system?
Okay,
that will help the economy.
Well, thank you very much. First, the policies we have on ground, right? They are very good policies on paper.
Mm-hmm.
They are very good. I think
on paper I like.
but I think the gap there is implementation and follow up. Because we may start the project and then follow up, don't conclude. Then getting the right authorities in each of the individual fields of agriculture. Getting the right authorities. If you're getting an agronomist that knows what they are doing, with the technical expertise and the right trainings. So we've put them in the right offices. So once a project is launched, we are very sure that we're going to have implementation, execution, and conclusion. Yes, that's what we're very sure of. So we have to get the right manpower. Secondly, we are to the whatsoever proposals are brought forward, we must bring in the right implements, the right tools. Yes, so if we are going to get subsidies, we're going to get subsidies for the right the right farming equipment to come in, and then we're also going to have to get the sub, and we're going to have access to, as I said earlier, on lands, and then we'll now ensure vocational trainings for, even if you have the agriculturists on the ground, vocational trainings that will increase awareness. Now, we have the new wave of artificial intelligence and AI that's been championed by Dr. Bosun, the Honorable Minister Dr. Bosun. Now, the way that wave is going is the same way the wave of agriculture should also be moving. Because artificial intelligence cannot exist in a vacuum. It needs a platform to work on. So agriculture will also need that introduction too, right? And it will facilitate the execution of agriculture. And we're going to see a very large return on our investment within the shortest period of time, because that's what technology is there for. Technology is there to maximize whatsoever efforts we put in.
Wow, interesting. You know, we can go on and on and on. As she said earlier on, agriculture is about me, you, her, everybody. It touches everybody. It is what we live. We have to eat through agriculture. We have to live through agriculture. But then we can go on and on and on and on. So a word of advice to everybody out there. It's not just the government. It concerns everybody.
Okay, our Nigeria is a very, very, very great nation. I am so proud of this nation. I've had opportunities to leave. I've had invites. But every time I look at those nations as very developed nations. What do they need me for again? What we're going through in our nation, Nigeria, this process, they've gone through the process. We are in our own process. And what I would want us as a nation to do is to come together. Our president is trying to ensure we bring in the right investors in the right sectors. And it requires a people of huge optimism to be able to ensure that whatsoever policies are put on ground, we put our hands together and ensure those policies come to light. But it doesn't, Me alone cannot do it.
Exactly.
She alone cannot do it.
We have to come together.
Everybody to come together. We need to stop talking down on our nation. We need to start highlighting the excellencies that our nation is for. If we can leave the shores of Nigeria and become individual superstars there, why can't we be a national superstar? Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ijoma.
Thank you.
You know, it's a good one.
It is.
Thank you so much for coming on the program.